Good evening, everybody. Again, I'll reiterate, it's an honor to be here. Just my wife and I and my family has been so blessed again, just to even to be able to come here and be a part of this family. Just like I said last week, let's open in prayer. Father, we just love you. We just thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your inexplainable love for us. Jesus, we thank you for coming to this earth and shedding your blood that we could walk in newness of life and be with you now and forever. And Holy Spirit, thank you for living in us and being here with us, amongst us. And yet, my prayer tonight, Lord, again, is that nothing would be said that wasn't of you, that isn't of you, and that every single heart and eye and ear would be open to being sensitive specifically to what you'd have to speak to us all individually and corporately. So have your way with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So when I was 28, I came to know the Lord. I had not known the Lord at all the first 28 years of my life, and so I had already been practicing in my practice for about 3 years and really enjoyed what I did as a doctor, just really enjoyed it. And then I came to know the Lord and had what people would call a radical transformation of my life, just completely. And the way it worked out is at that time I was either at practice or I was reading my Bible, and that was pretty much it. I was either at my practice or I was reading my Bible, and the Lord was leading people into my lives to help guide me and mentor me. But it doesn't take too long to read the Bible cover to cover if you're reading it 4 to 6 hours a day. It just doesn't take that long. And it didn't take me too long to ask my friend, my mentor at the time, and I just said, I'm really not sure what to do. And I said, because I don't know why I need to keep practicing as a doctor when, as I read my Bible cover to cover, specifically as you get into the New Testament, there are very specific promises of healing, very specific, and I knew them all, and I just said, I'm really struggling with continuing to practice as a doctor because the Bible says that if we just lay hands on the sick, they shall recover, and by the stripes of Jesus, we're healed. And so I really went through a time, and he encouraged me. He said, Terry, you know, God has a purpose and a reason for doctors. And I said, yeah, I kind of understand that, but I said, I don't really understand that. And he just said, hang in there. And he said, keep praying. And I just prayed, and I just said, Lord, I don't want to do anything you wouldn't have me to do. I know that, you know, this is what I went to school for, and I spent a lot of time there, and this is my vocation, but I don't want to live the rest of my life not doing what you've called me to do. And that was my prayer. And I honestly had that prayer for a long time. And I would just wrestle, and I would struggle with the Lord, and I would just say, I don't know. I'm not sure that I need to do this. I think if we just teach people the Word of God, and we rely on the promises of God, and we do things God's way, I'm not quite sure that I need to do what I'm doing. And so over years, many, many years, he's led me to a place to now I have more clarity. I'll just say that. I have more clarity on exactly what he'd have me to do. And how to do it and what he's called me to do. The word doctor, one of the things that I teach in my practice, the word doctor means teacher. That's what it means. It means teacher. So depending on the type of doctor that you are, may dictate what type of teaching you do, but ultimately doctor means teacher. And so God gives us doctors to help lead us and help guide us and help teach us on different things. So there's a scripture we're gonna start with here. 3 John 2, so the third epistle of John, the second verse. You may have heard it before, but I think it's really important because it says, Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. And so this is an amazing promise of God, right? Again, last week, one of the things that, you know, we talked about was with God, all things are possible, right? But the question is are we what? Are we with God, right? So here's this amazing you know, a letter here. It says, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in what things?" And it's not up here, by the way, and it's not back there, by the way, as well. So in all things, and be in health just as your soul prospers. And that word health means to be sound in body, in good health. So what does it mean? To be sound in body, in good health. And who's saying that this is what he'd have for us? Who's saying that? The Lord's saying that. He's saying that he'd have us to be in good health, to be sound in body. So there's a couple, well, there's actually quite a few things if you'll look over here about the human body. You look at the human body, the human brain is 80% water, right? It's pretty amazing. There's a, if you ever were to actually pull a brain out of somebody's body, I don't encourage you to do that, right? But if you were able to actually pull it out shortly after someone's perished and you would lay it on something solid, within a matter of minutes, it literally would, you know, go like silly putty. So our human brain is 80% water, yet it uses 20% of the oxygen in our bloodstream. Listen to this now. For you younger people, I'll explain this to you here in a minute, but it has 5 times more storage capacity than the entire Encyclopedia Britannica. So an encyclopedia is this book, right? And you would look it up and it would have all this information, right? Think of Wikipedia, right? So the human brain has 5 times more storage capacity than the entire Encyclopedia Britannica. You get a new stomach lining every what? 3 to 4 days. So if you're 84 years old, you have a stomach lining that's 3 or 4 days old, right? Hallelujah, right? The acid in our stomach is strong enough to dissolve what? So the acid in our stomach is strong enough to dissolve razor blades, yet does it do that? Does it eat away? No. That it's strong enough to do that, but because we continually have this new lining, we can withstand that. We have 60,000 miles of blood vessels in our body. Pastor Chad probably has about 70,000 miles, okay? And so the distance around the earth is 25,000 miles, right? But if you were to extend out all of our blood vessels, it would equal 60,000 miles. How amazing is that, right? That's amazing. There are over 500 known different liver functions, and quite honestly, as we study the body, there's probably 20,000, but there's over 500 known different liver functions. The left lung is smaller than the right to make room for our heart. Left lung has 2 lobes, right lung has 3 lobes. The tooth is the only part of the human body that can't repair itself. I think that's unfortunate. I might ask God about that when we get there. It's like, why couldn't the tooth repair itself, right? If all our DNA was stretched out, so our DNA is our genetic material, was stretched out, it would reach to the moon how many times? Inside of our human body. Approximately 2/3 of our body is water, which is almost the exact ratio of the amount of water on the earth, right? Our blood is 92% water, brain 80%, muscle 75%. Listen to this about the eye. This is quite amazing. The human eye is composed of over how many parts? 2 million. The human eye, 2 million working parts. It has the equivalent of 576 megapixels, right? Apple has gotten up to how many? 8 megapixels. Good for them, right? The human eye can process 36,000 bits of information every what? And we do not actually see with our eyes, we see with our what? Brains. The eyes are simply the camera, right? Pretty amazing. There's more. So keep kind of letting that sink in a little bit, right? About 32 million bacteria call every inch of your skin what? Yeah, some people are like, that's disgusting, right? But the reality is without bacteria, the human body wouldn't exist, right? When God made man, he grabbed what to make him? And if you ever play in dirt, you're going to find what? Bacteria, right? 32 million bacteria call every inch of our skin home. That's amazing to me. 300 million cells die in the body how often? Every minute. Every day, an adult body produces 300 billion, with a B, what? New cells. So every day, right? Psalm 105, if you read it, is one of my favorite verses in Psalm 105. It says, he renews our youth as the eagle, right? In my practice, man, I just don't really, I address it when people say I'm getting old, right? Oh, I think I'm just getting old. And I'm like, yeah, God made everything. Look, he can make you to live 80 to 120 years with incredible health if you'll let him, right? We shed and regrow our skin cells about every 27 days. Really quite amazing, actually, that your skin, right, same thing. You'll look at it sometimes and you'll say, boy, that's just not looking so good. It's less than 27 days old. Human lips, I think this is amazing, have a reddish color because of the great concentration of tiny capillaries just below the skin. The largest cell in the human body is the female what? Egg, and the smallest is the male sperm. So think about that. The largest cell in the female body is the egg, and the smallest cell is the male sperm. Your eyes are always the same size from birth. That's pretty amazing. That's, you know, part of what makes babies so cute. But your nose and ears never stop growing, right? So I have news for you, right? It's only going to keep changing, right? Every time I see my dad, I'm like, man, I love my dad. His ears and nose just keeps getting bigger, right? It takes 200 muscles working in coordination to take one step, right? We don't really think about that, right? Another thing, you know, to be thankful for and grateful for, your heart beats 100,000 times a day and will pump over 800 million pints of blood during our lifetime. At birth, this is amazing to me because I think most people don't really think about this or have never really learned this. At birth, a baby girl has 1 to 2 million immature eggs at birth, right? So think about that. You say, how old am I, right? I just turned 44, right? So I'm not 44 really. I'm 44 plus however old my mom was when I was conceived, right? How old my mom was when I was conceived. However old my mom was, yeah, you get it. I'm older than 44, right? Throughout a female's reproductive life, from puberty until menopause, about 400 of these eggs will attain ovulation. Pretty amazing. And then lastly, I teach this in my practice a lot too, because it ties in with Psalm 103. Every year, 98% of all of our atoms in our body are what? So 98% of what makes us us is replaced every year, right? So again, we don't really get to say I'm getting old, right? We can think we're getting old. We can feel like we're getting old. But if you remember Caleb in the Bible, right, when he spied the promised land, he was 45 years old, right? And then when he entered it, 40 years later, he was 85, right? But then the Bible said he had just as much vigor at 85 as he did at 45. What, God only loves Caleb? No. No, we can have that same vigor if we'll do things what? God's way. With God, all things are possible, right? It's just very important to understand that, what he would have for us. But what made Caleb different? Caleb and Joshua, they knew how strong their God was, and all the other spies didn't. Caleb and Joshua entered the promised land, and the other spies didn't, right? Because why? Because they were with God. You see the difference? And that's where we want to be, is we want to be with God. So if you look in Genesis 1, right, it says, so God created mankind in his own what? Image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Then God said, skip over verse 28. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for what? Food. So again, you know, you read the Bible and there's so much in there. It's like, here we are, Genesis 1, and he's telling us everything about creation. He tells us about us. He tells us that we're called to have dominion over the earth. And then verse 29, he slips this in. Why would he slip this in? What's the importance of that? Right? It's quite amazing. It's like, if it's not important, then it wouldn't what? It wouldn't be there. Right? He says, then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. So we'll come back to that here in a little bit, and just kind of chew on that a little bit. Psalm 139 really, you know, summarizes kind of what we went through. Here's King David, and I just love this, and I share this a lot as well. It says this. He says, I will praise you. So what does he say he will do? He says, I'll praise you. He says, because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my what? My soul knows well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. So one of the things that over the years that really, really gets me excited, fired up, it gets my blood going, is that a lot of people don't have this deep into their soul. They don't have that. They've believed a lie. And they believe the lie that they're not fearfully and wonderfully made. Right? And they believe the lie that God is not for them. And God is for us, and he has fearfully and wonderfully made us. So again, let's go through this. We should be able to sing this. We should be able to shout this out. He says, I will praise you, Lord, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows what? Very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. So after reading those first two, you know, snippets, right, did people start to believe that they're fearfully and wonderfully made? Right? Raise your hand if you believe that, right? We're totally fearfully and wonderfully made. We have 576 megapixel eyes. I mean, that's just the coolest thing ever, right? It's like, I just think that's amazing. So if we look here, where does nutrition fall into this thing? So if you'll go to the next slide here. Number one, we are a spirit. So we are a spirit. And just to kind of focus on that, we're either born again or we're not. We've either accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, or we haven't accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. When we're born again of what type of seed? Anybody know? Come on, let's try that again, right? Here's the answer, incorruptible, right? And so I'll ask you, we're born again of what type of seed? Incorruptible seed. That's amazing to know that when you're born again, that born again spirit is incorruptible, right? It's amazing. It's perfect, right? For God has not given us a spirit of fear or timidity, but of power, love, sound mind, and self-control. So 2 Timothy 1:7, you know, that's what we have. That spirit is what comes in us, right? Greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. That's what we get in exchange for sin. That's what we get. We get born again spirit. It's amazing. So then there's only two parts left, right? That first part's taken care of. When you say yes to Jesus, when he reaches out to you, when you say, heck yes, that's what you get. That's an amazing exchange, right? There's only two parts left then, right? Those two parts, soul and body. That's what's left. And those are the two parts that he says, okay, I give you that spirit. I give you grace. Now you work on that. So Miss Linda, if you don't mind raising your arm, if you would, please. Thank you, Miss Linda. And Mr. Sonny, if you don't mind raising your arm. These two, amongst others, have really been integral in our church and helping others go through Sozo, right? And Sozo is about helping that soul get clean. Get cleaned up, the truth, get strongholds released. And then the last part is that we live in this thing called a body, right? So when we look at nutrition, we talk about what we're going to talk about tonight primarily is, okay, what's the deal with nutrition? Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter, right? And where's God on this, right? We want to speak where God speaks. We want to figure out where he's not speaking. So nutrition, number one, is we're not under the law, right? You're not going to go to hell, right, because you eat Oreo cookies, right? At least I don't see that in the Bible, right? That's not going to happen. Now, you may get to heaven quicker, right? You may get there quicker. Ecclesiastes 7:17 says this, do not be foolish nor be overly wise. Why should you die before your time? Ecclesiastes 7:17, right? Do not be foolish nor be overly wise. Why should you die before your time? A lot of people are like, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know the Bible said that. Yeah, the Bible says that, right? Because we can do things that are whose decision? Ours, our decision. And so then we play a role in that, right? So we're under grace. We want to be spirit-led. The thief comes to do what? Steal, kill, and destroy. That's what Satan comes to do. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. John 10:10. So who do you think wants you to do harm to your body or soul? Who wants to do that? Satan does, right? He wants to steal, kill, destroy anything and everything that he can in your life. So again, who do you think wants you to abuse alcohol? Who do you think wants that, right? The enemy does. Who do you think wants you to utilize and abuse drugs? The enemy does. What about cigarettes? Who do you think wants you to be addicted to cigarettes? Right? Who do you think wants that? Do you think Jesus does? No, the enemy does. That's what he wants. Right? Lack of exercise. Who do you think wants you to not exercise? Think about that. Right? Who do you think? That's the enemy of your life. Satan, he wants you to not exercise. Right? That's his plan. And when it comes to nutrition, and I put nutrition in quotes there, because who do you think wants you to abuse your body? Who do you think wants that? Right? The enemy does. That's what he wants. Right? If you look back, it's amazing. One of the things back in the day, if you look at commercials or you look at magazines, you would see commercials that said, "My doctor smokes Camels," right? You may have seen that before, right? You can look it up. You can actually YouTube it, right? And that was before it became a consensus that cigarettes were what? Good or bad for you? Bad for you, right? It's a consensus. Again, it doesn't mean that you're a bad person. It doesn't mean anything like that. But I think it's a consensus at this point that cigarettes are what? They're harmful. They're not good for us, right? So when we look here, we want to look at a grace-based, so God extends grace to us. We want to be led by God's Spirit, a healthy lifestyle. And it really ties into fasting because there's different types of fasting. So the Holy Spirit really wants us to take care of our bodies. I know this definitively because I've prayed about this more than you could ever imagine, right? And I'll just talk with the Holy Spirit and we'll just commune and we'll just talk. And a lot of times when I'm working out, he's like, "Man, you see how that feels? You see how good that is for you? I'm right here with you. I want this for you," is what the Holy Spirit will say. And we'll just talk about that the same way with nutrition. So why would he want us to eat healthy? Why would he want us to get good sleep? Why would the Lord want us to be anxious for nothing? Why is that? Because he loves us. He's crazy about us. The Lord is crazy about us, and he made our what? Bodies. He made our bodies. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. And then in addition to that, he gave us this stuff called food. Did you ever notice that? He filled the earth with all of these amazing things. And just like so many other things, the enemy came along and did what? Twisted it and corrupted it, right? God designed sex, right? God designed sex. And the enemy comes along and does what? Twists it and corrupts it to where a large percentage of the world is twisted and corrupted regarding sex. Yes or yes, right? And it's the same way with a lot of these other things. It's the same way with nutrition. It's the same way with exercise. It's been corrupted, and there's two different camps on it. And I'll kind of tell you the two camps, and then we'll talk about what I believe God is saying, all right? So our bodies by nature do not want to be disciplined. And do want to be in control. That's what our bodies want. Our bodies primarily yearn to not be disciplined and do primarily want to be in control. Who's ever heard of an alarm clock? Raise your hand, right? So if you've ever had an alarm clock and it's ever gone off at a time that you felt was the best time for you to get up, right? Based upon responsibility in life, has your body ever said, "What the heck," right? Has it ever said snooze? Has it ever said no, right? Why? Because you made a decision the night before that said, "I need to be up at 6 a.m., right? When that alarm clock goes off, your body says, "I want to be in control," right? Does that make sense? So given the choice of cake or a salad, in most cases, our body will choose the most what? Pleasurable choice, right? Fasting. You know, we're in this fast. Pastor Chad is a math guy. And I think your math was off a little bit because I think you said something about like, "We're almost there, we're almost home." By my math, today's the 13th, right? And we started on the 2nd, so we finish on the 24th, right? So I don't even think we're halfway there. I think we're maybe 48% there, right? So my body immediately said, "Your math is off," right? And it just shows how the body thinks, right? It's like, "We're not halfway there, Chad. I mean, I don't know if we are." So again, we get to choose. We get to make the choice. Ideally, again, how? Spirit-led, right? Choose this day, what? life or death. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your... Wait a minute. Wait, what's that say? You are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Right? And if you preface, if you look before that, they're really talking a lot about sex, right? But if you read the scripture, I think the main thing there is that you're not your what? You're not your own, right? We're his. And if we're his, then we might want to learn, how do we take care of this thing, right? What's the best thing for this body, right? Whether it feels good or doesn't feel good, right? What's the best thing for it, right? And so there's some consensuses or consensi, right? There's some consensus in relation to this is good for you, this is bad for you. And then when you enter into the church environment, it becomes sometimes either clear, you know, even clearer. It's like, hey, we do not do that, right? That's bad, right? We have intimacy within the marriage relationship, right? We don't get drunk. You know, that typically tends to be a consensus. We don't do drugs. That tends to be a consensus. We do not watch porn. That tends to be a consensus in relation to we're in agreement. Now, we may still struggle with some of those things, but that's pretty much the consensus. When it comes to nutrition, it's pretty much, hey, the more sugar, the better, right? It's kind of like, hey, we can't have any of that other stuff anymore. Like, you know, God has said no, and I'm in agreement with that. But hey, bring me some cinnamon rolls, all right? All right? Because I want to, that's the one thing that makes me feel good. And that's not how we want to be, right? We want the thing that makes us feel great is the Lord, the Holy Spirit, and that's how we live our lives, right? So he has said, so we're going back to what we shared last week. If you go to the next slide there, please. Luke 10:27 from the Message Bible. So they asked Jesus, you know, what's the great commandments? And he says this. He said this, that you love the Lord God with, what's that next word? All. All your passion and all your prayer and all your muscle and all your intelligence, and that you love your neighbor as well as you do what? Yourself. There's a lot there. There's a lot there. And again, I'll just tell you that in and of yourself, you can't do this. You can't do it. I can't love the Lord God with all my passion in and of my flesh. I can't do it. It's only through the Holy Spirit that that's really possible. And prayer. And then what's that next word? Muscle. And intelligence. And that you love your neighbor as well as you do yourself. So again, as we said again, one of the themes has been with God, all things are possible. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice or fear, but he has given us a spirit of what? Of power and of love and of what? Sound judgment and personal discipline. Abilities that result in a calm, well-balanced mind and self-control. I have this scripture memorized, I have this scripture memorized in about 4 different translations. And the reason for that is because I've recited it about 10,000 times, right? Because there's been times in my life when I really struggled with fear, right? This, you know, I've struggled with fear, and yet because I've known the scripture, I'm like, that's not of God. That is absolutely not of God, right? I am not called to live in fear. He has not given me a spirit of fear, right? And as I've memorized this scripture and, you know, literally I'm like, okay, Lord, give me another revelation on it. You know, I do not want to live in fear. I'm not going to live in fear. It's not of you, right? You would not have this for me. And so as I memorize that scripture, along with that has come, it's not only what he hasn't given me, right? He hasn't given me a spirit of fear, but what he has given me. And not only what he's given me, but everyone who has given their life to Christ, this is the spirit that you get, right? He gives us a spirit of power. Right? And it's unique to all of us in relation. He gives us power in different ways and different things. And of what? Love. Right? If I ever have caught myself not living in love, I'm like, wait a minute here. That's not what he gave me. He gave me a spirit of love. And then lastly, as it comes down here, just in my experience in working with patients, they'll say, I just don't have any discipline. And I'll say, I don't know. And especially if I know they're a believer, I'm like, yes, you do. You have discipline. You just, your soul and your body is getting in the way of it. You've got to know that you have a spirit that gives you the ability to be disciplined in him. right? It's just very important to understand that, right? So again, a different translation for the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and what? Self-discipline, self-discipline. All right, next. Philippians 3, just again, diving through the Bible. For many walk of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even what? What's that word? Weeping. So the Apostle Paul is writing this, right? And he tells you, he says, I'm crying right now that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on what? Earthly things. So again, there's things in the Bible that oftentimes we haven't seen, we haven't really looked at, and we need to look at, you know, how that can help us. Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, no revelation of God and his word, the people are what? They're unrestrained, right? But when there's a vision, and this is something, again, since I became born again 16 years ago, you know, I've just prayed to God, and there's all kinds of nutrition programs, and you can read books, and you can read all these things, and some of them are Christian-based, and I'm like, okay, what is the truth, God? What truth would you actually have for us? How would you speak to us? And he speaks to us through the whole Bible, and again, just understanding that he gives us revelation about taking care of our body. With the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us is love, unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience. Look at this. This is powerful. Patience, not the ability to wait, but what? How we act by waiting, right? So it's like, okay, yeah, I'm being patient. But how are we acting while we're waiting? That's a good sign of whether that spirit is really, you know, got have some fruit in us. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and again, what? Self-control. So there seems to be a theme here, right? So again, number one, as we just go through nutrition, start with prayer, right? As I share this with you, pray. Pray to God. And that's been my prayer the whole time leading up to this. It's just pray. Ask the Lord, you know, to help you. Ask the Holy Spirit to guide you. Number two, fast. We really have clarity, and I believe many people in this church have seen that 2016 is a year of fasting and that God's called us to fast. And that oftentimes a part of fasting is what I call lifestyle fasting. And it's just that you are choosing to basically walk in discipline in how you take care of your body. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. And it's, again, yes, can you eat these other things? Yes, you can. Is it best for you? No. Do we know that already? Yes. If I told you a Twinkie's bad for you and grapes are good for you, I don't think that's, oh my gosh, he's so anointed, right? He's so gifted. I had no idea of that deep wisdom that he passed on to me, right? We already know that on some level. Yes, I'm going to teach you some things, but ultimately it's about understanding that I truly believe if we'll ask the Holy Spirit to show us and to guide us and direct us and say, what would you have for me? He would show you a better way or how to optimize what we're doing with our body, but we've got to be willing to do that, all right? Next, all right. It's a slide I show a lot. The food you eat can be either the safest and most powerful form of medicine or the slowest form of what? Poison, right? And that's just a reality that when we put food into our body, food doesn't heal us. Let me repeat what I just said. You ready? Food does not heal us, right? Food supports design, supports design. When God put us here, he also put food here. And he said, this is for you, right? So food doesn't heal anybody. And that's one of the big things that where I differ from a lot of other doctors, and they'll say, that, hey, if you take this, this will heal you. If you eat this, this will heal you. It's not going to heal you. It's going to support what God designed, all right? Very important to understand that. Food's not your healer. Food's not your healer. God's your healer. Right? And I don't like it when food gets the credit for what God has done and what he's doing, right? That being said, the food you eat can either be the safest and most powerful form of medicine, or I would use the term support, or the slowest form of poison. Next, I want to show you a chart here. I show this a lot, and it's quite mind-boggling. That is a map of the United States, right? So it's not a map of that thing that Chad did, you know, of all those different countries, right? This is the U.S. 1991, you'll see on the top left, and the colors are represented by the percentage of obesity. So you'll see there that the most obese states in 1991 were that color blue, right? I don't know what color blue that is, right? And then as you go to the right, that's 1993 to 1995, you'll notice new colors. And as you notice new colors, that's a higher percentage. So now we get into the greater than 15% and less than 20%. So if you look at 1991, the most obese states were in that between 10 and 15% of the population was obese. 1993 to 95, we get a new color. We go to 1998 to 2000, we get a new color, we get purple, right? That's when Barney was coming along, right? So we get 20 to 25, and then you get 2008 to 2010, and we get two new colors. So with the orange color being greater than or equal to 30% obesity. So from 1991 to 2008 and 2010, so a span of 17 to 19 years, we see a dramatic, dramatic, dramatic change in obesity, but obesity correlates as well with overall health. So in 17 years, we see this dramatic change, right? And the question is, why is that, right? And if you look before that, 1991, it was pretty much all pretty standard, right? So we're going to walk through why that is. Next slide. So this is our children in America today. So we showed a map earlier of adults. Now this is our children. So this is not obesity, this is overweight or obese. So notice as well, it's a comparison with all other countries, right? And what do we see? Who leads the world in obese kids and overweight kids? America, right? Who do you think wants that? Who do you think desires that? Right? The thief. Because the thief comes to do what? Comes to steal, kill, and destroy, right? It doesn't make anybody bad if they're overweight or they're obese at all. It just means we want to look and figure out, hey, how can we do this better or differently? How can we improve our overall health? Does that make sense? Right? That, to me, is just startling. And why us? Why are we the worst? Right? We're America, right? Shouldn't be so bad. Next slide. So if we look at this next slide, now we get to see this is sugar consumption. So on the left, you're going to see kilograms per individual of sugar consumption, right? One kilogram is 2.2 pounds, just to give you an idea. So, and then on the right, the solid line on the right is prevalence of obesity, okay? So you'll look and see how that graph goes, and then you'll see just a continual rapid increase specifically in the last 30, 40, 50 years. And so now we're up to the average American adult ingests 150 pounds of sugar per year. 150 pounds, right? And it's funny when I talk to patients about this, they're like, I don't even have sugar in my house. Like, we don't even use sugar anymore. I'm like, it doesn't just come from the white stuff in the canister, right? It comes from all of these other places. And then the correlative is in sugar consumption, what happens is that with that comes all kinds of other diseases. Sugar is an anti-nutrient. So you'll see that on the top left. Sugar is an anti-nutrient, which means it literally gets in the way of your body absorbing nutrients. So when we ingest sugar, it blocks our body's ability to receive nutrients from other foods that we may ingest. Number two, sugar feeds cancer. So the thing about cancer that's quite interesting is it's not as bad as it makes itself out to be kind of in our culture. Cancer can only basically live on sugar in a non-oxygenated acidic environment. So we can turn the table on cancer usually quite quickly if we can get things moving in the right direction. And then number three, in the last couple years, sugar has now been categorized as a carcinogenic, which means it's a known cancer-causing agent. It's carcinogenic, right? Just like cigarettes are carcinogenic. Sugar is carcinogenic, right? So when we look at, you know, how do we stay away from it? Just because science shows that it's bad for us, it's not about science as much as it is what would God have for us? What's God's best for us, right? And then what kind of lives will we lead? Will we lead a spirit-filled life, or we lead a flesh-filled life? right? One of the things that we're seeing, I believe culturally, and I think this will resonate with you, is that, man, we really struggle to be patient. We really struggle to be disciplined. We really struggle because there's that big battle between the flesh and the spirit, right? We struggle to say no in so many things. Next slide, please. So as we look here, one simple rule, ready? And then we'll kind of dive into some things. Pretty simple rule, right? If it came from a plant, do what? If it's made in a plant, don't. Pretty simple, right? If it came from a plant, eat it. If it's made in a plant, don't. So there's three avoids. There's three avoids when I teach nutrition. These are the three avoids. Number one, sugars and things that turn to sugar. Now, fruit has natural sugar, and that's a little different, but basically it's sugar and everything that turns to sugar. Number two is bad fats, because there actually is something known as good fats. And then number three is toxins and chemicals. These are the three things that really God didn't design for us. He didn't design for us to put into our bodies. Man designed these things. Man created these things, and so they weren't really designed for us. We can, if you will, deal with them or tolerate them, but they're not what's best for us. Next, McDonald's. In California has some different labeling laws as most states. So if you walk into a McDonald's in California, you're going to read what's on the bottom. Literally, you'll read this in every McDonald's in California. Certain foods or beverages sold or served here, including French fries and coffee, may contain acrylamide, a chemical known to the state of California to cause what? Cancer or birth defects or other reproductive harm. We do not add this chemical to our foods. It's created when certain foods are heated or browned. Changes things a little bit, doesn't it? Hopefully it does. It's not what's best for us, right? If Mrs. Jones, you know, you walk and see Mrs. Jones and Mrs. Jones' six-year-old smoking a cigarette, you know, you might talk to Mrs. Jones or call CPS or whatever you're going to do, right? But what about when we're putting these things into our kids' bodies, right? And we kind of look at it a little differently. That's kids. It doesn't matter what we eat anymore. It matters. Now, this is interesting, right? United States, McDonald's French fries in the United States on the left, McDonald's French fries on the right. You notice a difference. United States French fries has even more preservatives and additives and chemicals than the United Kingdom doesn't. Who has more sickness, United States, United Kingdom? United States. Who does God love more? He loves us all the same, right? But again, in our country, we have more relaxed laws. And the United Kingdom French fries, by the way, don't go there to eat the French fries. They're not even better for you anyway. But the ones on the left, specifically, you'll see in red, TBHQ. TBHQ as well has been proven to be a cancer-causing chemical. It's very powerful. Next slide. So again, God foods. I call them God foods, right? We take care of what we value. We're always going to take care of what we value. So I encourage us to take care of our bodies. Fasting equals abstaining. So a healthy lifestyle is a form of fasting. Just remember that. A healthy lifestyle is a form of fasting. But remember why you're doing it. You're not doing it for you. You're doing it in and of the Lord. God has given us incredible foods to enjoy. This is another thing that's really important. He's given us incredible foods to enjoy. Culturally, we have been deceived by two things, really. By the food industry, which is, again, seeking to tickle our tongue. They're seeking to sell their products, not necessarily seeking to make us healthy, right? We've been deceived by them, right? They don't make the foods to make us healthy. They make the foods to sell them. And in some cases, by religion, right? Because you'll hear people say things like, it doesn't really matter what you eat, right? That can be almost a religious statement. It doesn't really matter what you eat. No? It does matter what you eat, right? It matters because God knows what's best for us, right? And be like saying, it doesn't matter what you do sexually. It just really doesn't matter. No, it matters because God knows what's best for us, right? And it's the same way with nutrition. You know, he knows what's best for us, right? Acts chapter 10. A lot of times what people will mention is they'll use this one. This is one I hear a lot. It's Acts chapter 10. He says, well, didn't the Lord tell Peter to go eat some bacon? Isn't that what the Lord told Peter to do, just go kill and eat some bacon? No, he was telling him to go share the gospel with the Gentiles, right? And I don't know how many times I've heard, typically from men, right? They'll be like, well, the Lord told Peter to go eat bacon, so I'm just going to eat a lot of bacon, right? So let's look at this, right? I'm going to rock your world here, I believe. God's going to rock your world here, right? Don't eat this. Don't eat this, right? And I'm sure this will make you mad. Don't eat coyotes. Oh, dang it, that Dr. Harmon, man, he took away all my good food, right? Don't eat foxes, don't eat cats. I think by law you can shoot cats, but don't eat them, right? Don't eat horse. I'm kidding, I love cats, right? Don't eat horse, right? Don't eat donkey. Don't eat camel. Don't eat gorilla. Skunks. Wolverines. Walrus. Don't eat hawks, right? Don't eat a vulture. Don't eat flamingos, right? And when you say that, you would say, that's my Jesus, right? My Jesus, he's looking out for me, right? He's telling me in Leviticus, do not eat these things. And you're just like, that just makes sense. That's just a good God. That's a God who's looking out for me, right? And then there's a couple other in there. Ready? And then we're like, hey, that's Old Testament stuff, right? Right? That's Old Testament. I don't want to hear about that, right? He says as well, don't eat pigs and don't eat shrimp and crab and lobsters. And those are the ones that we say, wait a minute, don't be going law on me, right? I'm spirit-filled, I'm grace, that's how I live. When you look at all of the animals that God said in Leviticus to not eat, when he said don't eat them, why did he tell them not to eat them? Why did he do that, right? If you really study, he told them because those foods weren't good for them. They're not good for the human design. All of those critters God put on the earth to clean the earth. He put them on the earth to keep them, to clean the earth. The way that they're designed is what they do is they bring toxins into their body and they keep them there. So that if we eat them, guess what we get? We get the toxins. All the animals that he calls clean, when they eat, they're designed to get rid of the toxins. They're designed to poop them out. Right, Katie? Right? So, just a little joke between Katie and I, right? Just a little joke. Again, are you going to hell if you eat bacon tomorrow morning? No, absolutely not, right? Again, you just might go to heaven earlier, right? It's important to understand that as you read through the Bible and you understand what he's teaching us about nutrition and just take little glimpses here and there, it's because he has what's best for us. And that's really important. And then you and I and someone, we may differ. You may say, I just don't agree with that. Guess what? That's okay. Let's just keep looking. Let's just keep searching, right? Let's just keep looking for truth, right? But again, 16 years of looking and reading and praying and really looking and reading and praying, this is what he's shown me so far. Just really powerful. Next slide. So if we look here, here's another example, right? There's an apple on the right. So when you go to the store and buy an apple, it doesn't have a long list of what? Ingredients. It just has a number on it because you know what's in there. That's an apple, right? On the left, this one will kind of get you shaken up a little bit maybe. At least it has for others in the past. That is a Nutri-Grain bar, right? Commonly known as health food, right? We're like, hey, that's health food, right? I'm going to go to the store and get a Nutri-Grain bar, right? But look at its list of what? Ingredients, right? It's not exactly healthy. Why is that? Because what are we trying to avoid? Sugars, bad fats, and what? Toxins. Those are the things we're trying to avoid, right? These are man-made things versus what God has given us. And so you'll see things circled there, just absolutely loaded with, a Nutri-Grain bar actually is loaded with sugars, bad fats, and toxins, right? So I just want to teach you again basic principles tonight. Keep going, next slide. We're gonna rock about 8 more slides, so we're gonna go quick here, right? These are foods that fight what? Inflammation. And we're not gonna go through them all because we have kids, right? So if we look at it, as you look at this list, every single one of them, guess who gave us? God gave them to us. And as science starts to kind of look and unfold and dissect and everything else, every single one of them foods is known to fight what? Shown to fight infection or inflammation, right? So oftentimes as I teach this as well, and this is usually a good sign to you, is people will say, well, what the heck am I going to eat, right? You're taking away all my stuff. And I'll say, there's only about 900 foods you can eat, right? But typically what happens is we're used to eating a lot of sugars, bad fats, and toxins. That's what we've gotten into the habit of, right? And again, yes, we can say the prayer, you know, thank you, God, for this for this food. But on some level, it's like, he didn't really give us this. You know, we made this, but when you eat, I don't know, we'll just say a blueberry. When you eat a blueberry, like a ripe, amazing blueberry, man, for me, I'm just like, thank you, Jesus. This is amazing that you created this. And not only does it taste great, but man, you made it and it's good for me. Next slide. So these are foods that are known to starve cancer, and they're anti-angiogenic. Angiogenesis means that they get in the way of cancer spreading, right? So again, you can kind of, olive oil, maitake mushrooms, ginseng, turmeric, nutmeg, tomatoes, artichokes, apples, green tea, all of these are known. And again, I'm not really a wine fan, just so you know, but again, notice what you'll see there, red grapes, right? Red grapes. All of these foods have been shown to starve cancer / shut down the spreading of cancer. Again, who gave us these foods? God gave us these foods, right? And if we're honest, again, if we're just honest, oftentimes, again, our flesh may want the processed stuff, right? It may want it, right? And with that being the case, guess what we can do? We can pray. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Help me with this. I'm really struggling. We can pray and we can fast, and he'll give us the ability to put the things in our body that are best for us. Next slide. Spices, which are known to prevent or treat cancer. Again, I don't believe foods and spices and herbs heal cancer or heal disease. I believe they support the body and what it's designed to do, right? So again, you'll notice there that basically every spice and herb you could ever imagine, every single one of them is extremely supportive of the body, and God just happened to tell us that in Genesis 1:29. He just literally said, here, I'm going to tell you in the beginning. I joke about it a lot, but God knew that a lot of people would probably just read the beginning, the red, and the end. So first chapter is like, before you skip ahead, you're created in my image, and here's what you're supposed to eat, right? Next slide. So this is a great, I believe, summary, right? Summary. So number one, at the bottom is what? Unlimited vegetables. And this is just one, I love this picture though, unlimited vegetables. Number two is there's meats. Ideally, you want to get meats that are free range and grass-fed and et cetera. And Eden's Harvest is working on all this, right? It's working on all this. And then we have healthy fats. Healthy fats are incredibly important for the body. There's a couple there that I don't agree with on this chart because I didn't make this chart, but coconut and coconut oil, olives, olive oil, avocados, et cetera. And then the next one is fruits and berries. And then we have nuts and seeds. And then we have herbs and spices, right? So we're going to close with this. Katie, would you come up, please, as well? That's our signal for her to come up. We worked on that earlier. I want you to turn in your Bible to Romans chapter 12. So Bible, phone, electronic device, what have you. I'd like you to look at it if you have a Bible or electronic device, because I want you to look at it, depending on which translation you have. And then Pastor Chad as well, if you wouldn't mind coming up, because I'd like you to pray, and we're short on time. But if you would like prayer. Here's the thing. This is new to some people. This is different than you've ever heard before. This is, maybe a different way that you've ever looked at this before. But if you would like prayer for anything, we're 48% through the fast, Pastor Chad, right? We're 48%, right? We're 48% through the fast. And so this may be a good time to come forward for prayer. You know, just whatever you would like prayer for, anything you need. But Romans chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. And this is from the New King James Version. And there's just something big here. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Present your what? Right. It doesn't say present your souls, although he's going to talk about souls in verse 2. He says that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And he says here that you, who wants, we pray a lot, Lord, I want your will, right? Raise your hand if you want the Lord's will, right? But if you read Romans 12:2, he says that you may prove what is that good and perfect will of God, right? And so we take that out of context again. So with God, all things are possible. And he's saying, I want you to prove my will by what you do in your life, by your choices that you make. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Lastly is this, and the Holy Spirit is so good. As I was speaking there, he said, look, your food is not designed to be religious, right? It's grace-based, spirit-filled. Don't be preaching food to people. Don't preach food. I can't eat that. I can't eat that. No, I don't want to eat with you. If your friend invites you over and serves you McDonald's, hey, you know, you might say, thank you, Jesus, right? You got me off. Carrie and I, my God is good, right? Lord, have someone invite me over to give me some other food, right? I'm tired of this kale, right? It's horrible, right? It's not religion. It's the goodness of God. It's the goodness of God because he loves us. He knows what's best for us, right? Just really important to understand that moving ahead. Again, thank you so much for just being here and being willing to listen. And thank you all for, you know, allowing me to attempt to kind of chip away at this. So go ahead, Pastor Dad.
Come on, let's just give Dr. Harmon a hand. Thank you, Dr. Harmon.